Let's start the path for the validation of our battery management system. What is the first step to consider more? Well, we know from industry surveys that poor requirements management is the most common reason for embedded project failure. This includes missing, incomplete, or inconsistent requirements that don't capture the intended purpose of the project. For this reason, our journey starts with requirements management and, more specifically, how to manage requirements in our design environment, Simulink. Requirements typically come from Word, Excel, or more structured environments. In requirements management tools like DOORS or Polarion, for example. To implement these informal ideas into model-based designs is challenging when data is viewed and managed in separate tools. For example, it is difficult to establish traceability between requirements and design. To work with requirements directly in Simulink, there is an import operation for Word, Excel, DOORS, and support for the standard requirements interchange format, RECIF, that is supported by most requirements management tools. If requirements change at the source, then an update operation synchronizes the changes. The default is to treat external requirements as read-only, but if you want, as a Simulink user, you can then edit the requirements or add more details, such as custom attributes, for example, and then export. Additionally, you can also create requirements where Simulink is the source of the requirements. Finally, as I mentioned before, we can export requirements via RECIF, both the external requirements we modified in Simulink and the requirements we wrote directly in Simulink. Let's suppose we have an external document for the highest level requirements. For example, a Word file. Let's say the document describing the software architecture of our BMS. The document could contain the interfaces of the BMS control unit with the description of inputs and outputs enclosed in tables, the description of the software architecture with all the software modules that Francesco described before, and for each software module, again, the description of interfaces with specific information such as units of measurement, minimum and maximum of each signal, etc., etc. As you can see, the document could also contain images. Let's see how to import this Word document into Simulink.
Let's go to the apps, and here in the toolbar you can see a list of all the apps available to you. In particular, you can go down here in the model verification, validation, and test, and you can select the requirements manager. When we open the requirements manager, which is now on top of our tool strip, we can select Requirements Editor. From here, from the Requirements Editor, we can import and author requirements. So the first thing, let's import the requirements written in Word. So we can select Browse, we select the document, and then we can import. We click on Open, and then we can specify if we want a rich text or a plain text. So in this case, we select rich text. We give a name to this requirement set. And then we allow updates from the external source. And then we click on import. This will take a few seconds. It really depends on how many requirements you have and how big the document is. And after a little bit, you have all the requirements imported in Simulink. So on the right, you can see exactly all the requirements that we have imported. We can expand them all to see how many we have. And then we can take a look and see what they are. So once again, we expand all the requirements and we see that we have the list of all the requirements written in the Word document. So we can also jump to the location, to the source, by clicking in Show in Document, and here we can see that we jump exactly to the right location. So now let's assume that at some point you modify a requirement. So for example, you change something, and in this case, for the sake of showing this, we just add something. So we save the document, and of course this means that the source of the requirement has changed. So Simulink is able to detect this. Indeed, if we go on top here, we can see that now we have a little icon here that tells us that the source of the requirements has changed. So we can actually update the requirements in Simulink. And all we need to do is to click on Update, select the source of the requirements. And what this will do, it will update the requirements in Simulink based on the source. Now you can see that we have the requirement that was modified. Okay, so you can not only import requirements in Simulink, you can even author your own requirements directly in Simulink. So let's create a requirement set. Let's give it a name. And all you need to do to author your requirements is just to add them. And you can even add any desired hierarchy that you want. So for instance, here you have 1, 2, 3, but then you can also go on a deeper level and you can keep doing this. So, you know, of course, this will take a bit of time to author all the requirements, but all you need to do is to have a summary here so you can write anything you want. And then you can also have a description of what the requirements should be.
I have now implemented my own low-level requirements in Simulink. And usually what you want to do now, you want to create a bidirectional linking between the low-level requirements in Simulink and the high-level requirements in Word. So first thing, you select a low-level requirement, you right-click, and then you select for linking. At this point, you go back to a high-level requirement, you right-click again, and then you create a link. So after doing this, on the bottom right, you can see that we have created a double linking between the low-level requirements authored in Simulink and the high-level requirements imported from Word.
Now, let's go one step further. For the moment, we have seen how we can manage requirements in Simulink, imported from outside or written inside Simulink, in the requirements editor window. But how it is possible to see these requirements together with our design created in Simulink in just one integrated view? The answer is the requirements perspective. Let's go directly into Simulink to see how we can activate it. This was the requirement editor, a view to see and work with requirements conveniently. But if we go back to Simulink Design Canvas, we have the ability to enable two windows, the Requirement Browser and the Property Inspector, to see the Simulink design and requirements together. If you select a requirement in the Requirement Browser, you'll see all its properties on the right in the Property Inspector. These two windows together are the requirements perspective. If you close these windows, you can also reopen them just by clicking the badge in the lower right corner and selecting the requirement perspective. And we can see not only the high-level requirements, but by going inside the software architecture, we can open and navigate the set of requirements we wrote directly in Simulink, visualizing and analyzing them in the same way. A great help that makes us ready to implement without getting lost. maintaining consistency between the design and the requirements. Now, what is the next step? Well, obviously, the creation of traceability between requirements and design through bidirectional links. Let's see how easy it is to manage it in this integrated environment. We will now use a Simulink model where I have already created some links between the requirements and the design. If a link already exists, by selecting the requirement, we can see the block to which it has been linked, highlighted in pink. And on the right, we can see the link. Once the link has been created, an icon will appear on the top right corner of the Simulink block. If a requirement has not yet been linked, as in this case, the creation of the link is very easy to do, simply with a drag and drop. You can see the link just created, but seeing the icon on the block and on the lower right window. Let's show the input and the output tables. In some cases, it would be very convenient to have them on the Simulink design canvas, closing the window on the right. Well, this is possible. We can show or hide any requirements we have linked to the design directly on the Simulink canvas in this way. But also, for example, seeing the high-level requirements that describe the state machine. Let us now jump into the logic of the state machine. Here, too, we have many links already created, and to better visualize the design parts linked to the requirements, you can use the highlight functionality in the toolstrip. Another example of how it can be useful to have design and requirements together is to check the properties of an input. By showing requirements in this way and selecting the Simulink block, it is easy to check on the property inspector that its properties are consistent with the requirement. By better analyzing the state machine, you can see how the requirements can be linked even to the states that are highlighted in violet, and the mechanism is always the same. Again, if we don't have a link, we can create it with a drag and drop and see the links to the highlightings and the window on the bottom right corner. If we want to go into even more details, there are no limits, and even a single transition or an individual substate can be linked to a requirement. Summing up, this allows us to map every single atomic requirement to states and transitions in state flow or Simulink blocks, even to data that are present inside the Simulink data dictionary, obtaining a perfect traceability requirements design in a very fast way. There are many other advantages that we can obtain from a traceability created with the methods seen before. For example, it may be interesting for project managers to view the status of the requirements implementation. That's why we have included in the ability to view it directly in Simulink. So, if we do a good job linking the requirements to the design or justifying the non-implementation in some cases, we will have a clear view of the progress. Let's see how you can enable this view. Just right-clicking in the requirement browser, we can add the column. And for each paragraph, see the progress of the implementation. For example, the paragraphs concerning input and output interfaces have all been implemented. This means that we have linked them to the imports and outputs, probably checking all the properties. The situation is different for the state machine logic. For chapter 4.3, for example, this is not complete. Probably the design has been started or completed, but we still have to create links to the requirements.